Hi everyone, my name is Brad Kesser and I'm a professor of otolaryngology, head and neck surgery at the University of Virginia, specializing in otology and neurotology. Otology-Neurotology is the subspecialty within otolaryngology that deals with the ears. I see patients with hearing loss, balance disorders, dizziness, ringing in the ears. And so I'd like to review a recent Chicago Med episode, season 1, episode number 3, where a young girl presents to the emergency room having fallen and complaining of hearing loss.
Can you smile for me, Dylan? All right, now I'd like you to tilt your head to your left for me, all right?
I tried Nepley already. Didn't seem to help.
In the acute setting of seeing a dizzy patient in the emergency department, the smile is important to document one of the cranial nerves that runs with the hearing and balance nerve. Now, I'm not really sure why the doctor had the patient tip the head over, except maybe looking for what we call a doll's eye reflex to make sure that the eyes can track opposite to the head. The Epley maneuver in this acute setting probably would not be indicated. The Epley maneuver is a diagnostic maneuver to identify benign positional vertigo, which is a disease characterized by brief episodes lasting maybe 15 seconds of dizziness caused by a particle that has become dislodged in the inner ear. So the initial physical exam, I agree with the cranial nerve exam as well as the a basic eye movement exam, but I'm not sure at this point the Epley maneuver is necessary.
Can you hear this?
Yes.
How about now?
Not as well as the other.
You a musician?
Mm-hmm. Getting my master's at CCPA, the conservatory.
In this scene, the doctor is doing a tuning fork exam. It's a relatively crude assessment of hearing. However, in the office, the tuning fork exam can be very valuable in assessing the type of hearing loss a patient has. So in a crude way, I have my tuning fork, we can just assess generally the hearing. Can you hear that? Can you hear that? And in the scene, the patient clearly has a difference in hearing between the two ears. Now in a more rigorous manner, we test the hearing by putting the tuning fork on the nose or the bridge of the nose and asking the patient if you can hear the sound better or more toward one side. Interestingly, if a patient has a type of hearing loss that we call conductive hearing loss, which is a problem with the ear canal or the eardrum or the middle ear, they'll hear the tone louder in that ear. On the other hand, if the patient has a sensory neural hearing loss, they will tell you that they hear it louder in the opposite ear. So they didn't do that part of the tuning fork test, which could have given them valuable information as to the type of hearing loss the patient has.
Impressive. Follow my finger for me, all right? I don't mean to scare you, but becoming a doctor was actually my fallback plan. I wanted to be a musician, a violinist, in fact.
So as I mentioned earlier, eye tracking is an important component of the exam of the dizzy patient. The inner ear is closely yoked to eye movement, so when we turn our head right and left, like I'm doing now, I can maintain perfect eye contact because as my head turns right, my eyes turn left, and as my head turns left, my eyes turn right. So being able to document eye movement and the ability to track the finger is important. Now in just a second, they're going to talk about nystagmus, which I'll address in just after the next scene.
She's got a slight nystagmus in
her right eye, I know. And the hearing loss in the left, I'm thinking it could be syndromic.
Well, apparently you didn't need a consult.
Come on, I value your opinion. How come you never told me you want to be a musician?
You want an opinion? Call a neurosurgeon and send her for a stat head CT.
The doctors mentioned the term nystagmus. Nystagmus is a characteristic eye movement that goes back and forth. There's often a slow component and then a fast component that can be generated by diseases of the inner ear. In fact, if you want to watch nystagmus, have somebody close their eyes, turn round and round, and open their eyes. And you'll see the eyes going back and forth like that. Now, the eyes work together in concert. So when he says there's nystagmus in the right eye, that doesn't really make a lot of sense because the nystagmus is going to be in both eyes. One other mention is that they wanted to get a stat head CT. Now, in the setting of an acutely dizzy patient in whom you think there may be a stroke or a bleeding on the brain, a head CT is a very good screening tool to look for a stroke, to look for a hemorrhage in the brain, or a subdural or epidural hematoma, which is bleeding around the brain. However, a head CT might miss the primary diagnosis that we're going to discover in just a minute.
Has anyone from neurosurgery seen these yet?
They're talking about scheduling surgery as soon as possible.
Acoustic neuroma?
Tumors, essentially, caused by a genetic condition called neurofibromatosis. It disturbs nervous system cell growth. So these neuromas are pressing against your inner ear, and that's why you've been experiencing the hearing loss and the dizziness. We need to remove them and stop the internal bleeding.
So as I mentioned, a head CT would not be your diagnostic study of choice for acoustic neuroma. An MRI scan with and without contrast is the study of choice or the gold standard for diagnosing acoustic neuromas. Now, a large acoustic neuroma would be identified on a head CT, but a small acoustic neuroma may not be identified or may be missed on a head CT. An MRI is really the study of choice. Now, he also mentions this condition called neurofibromatosis. And I want to differentiate. There is neurofibromatosis type 1 and neurofibromatosis type 2. In the type 2 variety, patients have acoustic neuromas and other benign tumors of the central nervous system, but acoustic neuromas in both ears. So that would have been diagnosed really with an MRI scan. In addition, the doctor tells the woman that the hearing loss and the balance issues are because the tumor is putting pressure on the inner ear. Well, in fact, the inner ear is surrounded by the densest bone in all of the body. If you want to take the thickest bone, the densest bone in all the body, it's the bone that protects the organs of hearing and balance, the organ of balance. So in fact, these acoustic neuromas are pressing on the hearing and balance nerve and interfering with the ability of the inner ear and the ability of the hearing nerve and the balance nerve to deliver the signal back to the brain. Hence, the patients have balance dysfunction and they have hearing loss.
When?
As soon as possible.
What are the side effects?
There's a good chance you'll lose your hearing.
My hearing?
Yes. Dylan, I know it seems like your world is coming apart right now, but we got lucky here today. Okay, that fall you took might have just saved your life.
I'm a musician.
This could have killed you. You don't always get a warning sign. I want to transfer you upstairs and admit you into the hospital proper. Is that okay with you?
No. I want to talk to the woman who was in here earlier. The violinist.
Dr. Manny.
I am not going anywhere until I talk to her.
There are many, many warning signs prior to death approaching. If the tumors get very large, they cause headaches, they cause numbness on one side of the face, they can cause nausea, they can cause vomiting. So there are many, many signs that neurofibromatosis type 2 patients will exhibit or acoustic neuroma patients will exhibit prior to the approach of death or prior to a tumor such as this actually killing the patient. I'd like to stress, acoustic neuromas are benign, slow-growing tumors. Even in the setting of neurofibromatosis type 2, these tumors tend to be slow-growing. And many times, we'll just watch them and enable patients to enjoy their hearing for as long as they can. Because typically, treating these acoustic neuromas will cause hearing loss. Now, there are procedures that we can sometimes save the hearing, but it's important to know this is not a stat surgery. This surgery does not have to be done on an emergent basis. We do these acoustic neuroma surgeries on an elective basis. Importantly, to give patients time to process and understand the information and to understand their treatment options going forward.
She's not going to do the surgery, at least not until she's given the recital.
You told her those tumors might kill her first.
Hearing and being heard, it's how Dylan interacts with the world. She can't imagine her life without that ability. She needs more time to process all of this.
She doesn't have more time.
I don't know what to tell you. It's not our decision to make.
I don't believe this.
The woman doctor clearly is supporting patient autonomy here. And I think that's a really, really valuable and really important point. This is not in an emergency. This does not have to be done immediately. The woman, the young woman who has the neurofibromatosis type 2 can take time to process the information, to understand her treatment options. Even if the recital were next week, the surgery could be put off and done on an elective basis to allow this young woman to perform in her recital. I wholeheartedly applaud the woman doctor's expression to support patient autonomy. I have a couple of issues with the surgical scene. First of all, the patient's face would be covered. We do not want her nose and any kind of bacteria to potentially spoil the sterile field. Secondly, if you remember from the top of the show, the hearing loss was in the left ear, yet they're operating on the right ear. Typically, we would operate on the worse hearing ear first. Now, it may be possible, it's certainly possible, that the larger tumor, the tumor that's really causing brainstem compression, is on the contralateral side or the other side from where the better hearing is or from where the hearing loss is, in which case we would have to operate on the larger tumor. But nevertheless, in a young patient like this, we would want to preserve her hearing as best we could. Her right ear was her better hearing ear at the top of the show, and yet they're operating on the right side. Next, we operate under a microscope. This is delicate microsurgery, and just to sit and take a little piece of tissue out and hand it to the scrub tech is really not the way it goes. This is not cancer, so we don't need to do an en bloc resection. In other words, we don't need to take the tumor out as one big piece with margins of healthy brain around it. This is a benign tumor, so we can take it out piecemeal. And there are technological advances that have really enabled us to remove these tumors relatively quickly and efficiently in a piecemeal fashion. So we would absolutely do that under the microscope. And it's not that we take a tiny piece and we give it to the scrub tech to send to pathology.
How'd it go?
They got everything. She's gonna be fine.
And her hearing?
I'm sorry.
So they operated on the right ear, yet she did have some hearing in the left ear prior to surgery. Again, we would only operate on one ear or one tumor at a time, so her other ear, the hearing in the other ear, should be preserved, so they wouldn't necessarily have to write to her. In addition, her voice box and her speaking mechanism and her brain communication centers are all fine. I'm not sure why the writers or the director felt they needed to have her write back to the doctors. She should have been able to speak to the doctors without any problem. Now, very, very large acoustic neuromas can put pressure on the vocal cord and the speaking nerve, and that can cause hoarseness after surgery. But again, I don't see why she would have needed to write to the doctors. She could have easily spoken to them. So this episode of Chicago Med illustrates a young woman who's had a fall, we think because of an episode of dizziness. The show opens in the emergency department where the doctors are evaluating the source. Why did a young woman fall and have dizziness? They get a head CT scan to rule out a stroke or a bleed in the brain, and they find these tumors on her hearing and balance nerve that we call acoustic neuromas. Now, she has tumors on both of her hearing and balance nerves, so she has a condition we call neurofibromatosis type 2, which is defined as these benign acoustic neuromas on the hearing and balance nerve. Now, the treatment of acoustic neuromas is typically elective. I also want to reiterate that most acoustic neuromas are solitary, just one, unilateral, on one side, where the other ear is healthy and fine and the hearing is normal. This particular patient has neurofibromatosis type 2, which is a rare condition that causes tumors on both hearing and balance nerves. So both of her hearing nerves are at risk. The dramatic part is that they want to admit her and take her to surgery immediately. Well, in fact, the surgery can be elective. I do agree admitting her for observation, serial neurologic exams, or a serial head CT scan to make sure she doesn't have any additional bleeding in the brain would be indicated, but she does not need to be admitted for emergency surgery to remove the acoustic neuroma. In the show, the tumor is on the right side that they're operating, yet her hearing loss is greater on the left. We would typically recommend surgery to remove the tumor on the worse hearing first so that patients can enjoy their hearing for as long as they can before the tumor has to be either irradiated or removed. Because I will tell you, removing the tumor many times will result in a total profound sensory neural hearing loss. There are operations that we can do to try to save the hearing and remove the tumor, but these are challenging and only in the very best of hands are the very best results obtained. And even still, we can save the hearing in maybe 50 to 67, 65% of patients. Finally, she should be able to hear after surgery with the ear that was not operated on, and her expressive language, her ability to form words with her mouth and with her vocal cords, should be intact. So I don't know why she was asked to write on a piece of paper, other than potentially for dramatic inflection. So in summary, a good job overall by the directors. A few small points that I wanted to bring out that are relatively inconsistent with the way we manage patients with acoustic neuromas and neurofibromatosis type 2, and it's information that I think is important for you to understand as you watch Chicago Med. So I thank you for your attention, and be well and stay safe.